And now, to present the Rumford Prize for Physical Science, it's my pleasure to introduce Lucia Rothman-Denes, the A.J. Carlson Professor of Molecular Genetics and Cell Biology at the University of Chicago, where she has taught since 1974. Professor Rothman-Denes was elected a Fellow of the Academy in 2001. She served as Chair of Class II Biological Sciences and currently serves on both our Committee on Membership and Prize Committee. Please join me in welcoming Lucia Rothman-Denes.
So David has mentioned that I have been a member of the prize committee, and so it was at a meeting that I learned that this was the year of the Rumford Prize. And I immediately knew that the prize belonged actually to the development of optogenetics. I think I mentioned it at the meeting. So what I'm very grateful is that the committee to evaluate the nominations actually agreed with me. So I'm a microbiologist, and my interest actually in optogenetics was generated in the year around 2000. It turns out that I was a member of the PhD committee of a student in Keith Moffat's lab, Sean Crosson, and I was aware of what happens when you shine light on actually a photosensory domain of a protein. He actually determined the structures of the what it's called the lab domain. I did read all of the work leading to nowadays on the development of optogenetics, and I must say I'm not going to go through it. Actually, Ed is responsible for that today. But actually, it was what I would call really a beautiful and elegant trip in beautiful science, okay? So before I read the citation, I want to ask David and perfectly lined up. So established in 1839, the American Academy's Rumford Prize recognizes scientific discoveries that have the potential to fundamentally alter our understanding of heat and light and their potential applications. The prize is named for a physicist and inventor, Benjamin Thompson, Count Rumford, whose challenges to establish physical theory were part of the 19th century revolution in thermodynamics. In the words of Count Rumford, the prize is awarded for work in the opinion of the Academy tends most to promote the good of mankind. For remarkable achievements in heat and light, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences recognizes Ernst Bamberg, Edward Boyden, Karl Deisseroth, Peter Hegemann, Gero Miesenböck, and Georg Nagel for their extraordinary contributions related to the invention and refinement of optogenetics, a biological technique that makes use of genetically targeted light-sensitive proteins which can detect and control cellular activities upon light stimulation with really high temporal and cellular precision, and had a profound influence on cell. It really revolutionized the field of neuroscience and had a profound influence on cell biology, and in my case, actually, in microbiology. Named Insight of the Decade by Science in 2010, the field of optogenetics has furthered the scientific understanding of the inner workings of the cell and how specific cell types contribute to the function of biological tissues. It has been used to study the brain from various perspectives, actually from communication of a cluster of individual neurons to the interaction between large brain regions. Optogenetic-driven research has provided a significant insight into many neurological and psychiatric disorders, and most importantly, the use of optogenetics actually has a promise for therapeutic strategies to treat afflictions ranging from Parkinson's disease, depression, anxiety, schizophrenia, obesity, drug abuse, and certain types of blindness and paralysis. So with dedication, determination, passion, and extraordinary vision, you have delivered on science's promise to construct new ideas that illuminate the world around us and make a world a better place for all. And I should add, actually, that this prize has primarily gone to physicists, and I'm very pleased that it goes to biologists.
Right. Well, I've been asked to say a few words about what optogenetics is and the impact it's having. And but I want to start just by saying, on behalf of all six of us equal co-winners today, what gratitude we have to the jury. And also, it's exciting to see this kind of very interdisciplinary work that goes from microbiology to neuroscience to biophysics and everything in between recognized. And it's very collaborative work. I know many of us have worked together or as colleagues or as collaborators to try to bring these kinds of insights forward. Personally, I want to thank, of course, my family and especially my wife, who's very supportive throughout all these years. So what is optogenetics? Well, it's maybe useful to start by explaining the problem of the brain. So in the brain, of course, we have many kinds of cells, small cells and large cells, excitatory cells and inhibitory cells, and the cells change in different ways in different diseases. And one of the big questions, of course, is how do you know how a cell contributes to a pathological state of the brain or to a potential therapeutic state of the brain to overcome a disease state? Now, to compound this, there are two other problems of the brain. One is the spatial complexity of the brain. So in a cubic millimeter of the brain, you have about 100,000 cells called neurons, with about a billion connections between them. And that's just a cubic millimeter. Furthermore, these brain cells operate at very high speeds, biologically speaking. They operate with electrical pulses that occur inside the cells that last only a thousandth of a second. And the chemical exchanges between the cells, which are driven by the electricity, are also about a thousandth of a second, or maybe a little bit longer in duration. So one of the core questions is, well, if you can manipulate the neural activity, maybe you could figure out what these cells do. You could activate cells and figure out how do they trigger or sustain behaviors, pathological states, or therapeutic states. If you turn off cells, you can figure out what they're needed for. Are they important for a memory, or for a seizure, or for a Parkinsonian tremor? And so that's sort of the problem that optogenetics helps address. So how does optogenetics work? Well, it turns out that all over the tree of life, you can find these amazing molecules called opsins. And we have some opsins in our own eyes that convert light into signals that our brain can then understand. But some of the opsins that come from certain kinds of organisms and different members of our laureate set have used different opsins from species ranging from algae to fruit flies to bacteria to fungi. They have interesting properties. First of all, they can operate in a way that's different from the opsins in our eyes, in the sense that they are sustainable. They can convert light into signals repeatedly. The opsins in our eyes have a complex apparatus that maintains their state that's not present in ordinary brain cells. Secondly, these opsins can also sometimes convert light directly into electrical signals. And some of the six laureates were the key people to discover these light-driven ion channels and to characterize them. And then some of the others amongst us expressed these into brain cells as well. So why would you want to do that? Well, if you could take these molecules, which are proteins, and take the genes that encode for the proteins and put them into brain cells, and you can use many of these tricks from the field of gene therapy, where you can take a gene and put it safely and effectively into a brain cell, then you can shine light on the brain cell, the molecule will convert light into the signal, and you can then turn on or off the brain cell. So a lot of serendipity had to play a role in this. First of all, these molecules might not have worked in other cell types, but they did. And secondly, they might not have had the right speed and efficacy to actually mediate the kinds of signals that you want to mediate in brain cells, but they did. So the impact has been very broad in neuroscience. For example, you can activate a cell or set of cells and try to trigger a sensation and see whether a set of cells will actually cause a visual sensation or an auditory sensation. You can trigger sets of cells and figure out what kinds of movements can they drive. And maybe most broadly of interest, you can try to trigger sets of cells and see what kinds of changes occur in disease or health-promoting states. So the impact of this has largely been on model organisms commonly in use in neuroscience. So the worm C. elegans, the fruit fly Drosophila melanogaster, mice, and so forth. But by studying these simple brains, one can try to understand something about how more complex brains work as well. So investigators all over neuroscience are using these molecules to activate and shut down cells in the brain. You can try to turn off, in a mouse model of epilepsy, an epileptic seizure. And indeed, people have found certain cells that you can put these opsins into and then shine light and turn off the cells and shorten the duration of a seizure. You can try to turn off the symptoms of Parkinson's disease in these animal models of Parkinson's. So there are certain cells in the brain that if you stimulate will actually alleviate the symptoms of Parkinson's in these mouse models. You can try to turn off parts of the brain to see if that causes a memory to go away or activate a memory artificially. And so lots of people all over neuroscience are using these tools for interesting functions. The impact on health can come multiple ways. So one way, of course, is to use this basic science knowledge about the brain and then use that to inspire new therapies. So for example, I'll just give one example, which is sort of an interesting story, which was a recent study led by a collaborator, Li Wei Sai at MIT. And what she's been working on is Alzheimer's disease. So she used one of the opsins called chenodopsin 2 that was one of the key molecules that several of the laureates discovered, and used that to activate the brain at a specific frequency, 40 times a second. And so 40 hertz, 40 times a second, is sort of a magical frequency in neuroscience. It actually goes down in patients with Alzheimer's disease. And so her lab asked the question, well, can you boost these oscillations? And amazingly, in mice that are genetically engineered to get Alzheimer's-like symptoms, these animals got better. They actually had lower amyloid plaques and phosphorylated tau and other symptoms. And then Emery Brown, an expert on brain rhythms, came along and said, well, are there ways that you could do this non-invasively? So this is sort of where you go from the basic science to the design. And the teams then went on to figure out that you could actually induce these same brain rhythms through visual stimuli and even auditory stimuli. And so there are now human trials ongoing. And in fact, Li Wei and I co-founded a company, as my financial disclosure, I guess, to do human trials of movies to treat Alzheimer's disease. So it could fail. Lots of things fail to translate from mice to humans. But we should give it a try, right? It's a fairly simple thing to do. So these technologies are now in use by probably thousands of researchers at this point all over the field of neuroscience, studying behavior and studying disease and studying how to remedy diseases. And it's been a lot of very powerful discoveries and inventions made by the six co-winners today. Several of them discovered opsins and figured out how they work. Several figured out how to make them better through mutating them. Several discovered how to use them to control neurons and to turn these brain cells on and off. And a lot of interdisciplinary crosstalk has been very important, going back and forth between the molecules, the physics, the cells, and the applications. I think one of the other things that's really important to point out is that these molecules, of course, come from the natural world. And it's both a testament to the importance of ecology and the idea that a lot of the big inventions and discoveries in biology are from by looking at other biological systems and figuring out how to borrow those molecules and use them for other purposes. And that's not just true about this field, but you know, other fields like CRISPR and fluorescent proteins also are borrowing molecules from the natural world. And so one of the themes, I think, that emerges is just the importance of understanding the natural world and being open to serendipity, because you never know where a discovery might lead over the years. So I think that's all the content that I prepared, and I hope that I've been able to give you a flavor of the kinds of great work that's been going on, and thank you for your time.
Well, thank you, and please join me, everyone, in congratulating our prize winners one more time and in thanking Dr. Moniz and Dr. Boyden for their really fascinating talks. Our next meeting in Cambridge will be on Tuesday, May 7th. The program will be entitled Safe Spaces, Brave Spaces, Diversity and Free Expression in Education. The program will feature John Palfrey, who is head of school at Phillips Academy in Andover and the incoming president of the MacArthur Foundation. We hope that many of you will join us. And with that, the 2080th stated meeting of the Academy is dissolved.